I'm CK Raju. I'm coming from India. Shortly, I'll be going to Malaysia at the Universiti Sains Malaysia. I work in many areas: mathematics, physics, computer science, history and philosophy of science. And what brings me here is the issues that arise from my work. For example, the relationship of mathematics with theology, which requires that there has to be a change in the philosophy of mathematics. And this sort of thing is very difficult to, some parts of the West do accept it, but in general it is very difficult because it's anti-establishment. And so this requires a community which is going to take this sort of effort forward. And that's what I hope to find here.
Assalamu alaikum. Thank you very much for inviting me here. It is a great pleasure to be in this country and to share my experiences with you. And I think that these kinds of meetings, they have a lot of consequences. For example, the last meeting we had on academic imperialism, I have already received 4 requests based on that. One came from Malaysia, one came from Germany, and one came from the chairman of African Studies, SOAS, London, who's from Stanford University, who decided to distribute the talk. So it might seem that we are sitting out of the West and discussing this, but the West has to take notice. So I think these things serve a useful purpose because it clarifies our own thinking and it helps us to get over that kind of hegemony which has been imposed on us.
My name is Claude Alvares. I come from Goa, India. I am involved in learning projects, especially the Multiversity project, which concentrates on learning outside formal institutions. So we are interested in all the homeschooling, out-of-schooling experiments, and we are also at the university level involved in trying to ensure that most of the curricula that are used in social sciences are not contaminated by Eurocentrism. We feel that there is here a grand sympathy for these ideas among some sections of the population, and we are happy to come here and share these experiences and be with them. I am extremely delighted to be here back in Iran. When I first was invited to come to Iran, most of my friends warned me not to go there. And many people said that it is a very repressive society. The women are treated in a very restricted manner, and the politicians are very bad, and you will only have a negative experience when you go and stay in Iran. And amazingly, the same thing had been told to me when I was going to visit Pakistan. When I was going to visit Pakistan, most of my friends said, you know, be careful, you may not come back alive. But when I went to Pakistan, and when I went again to Iran, I found a completely 180 degrees reverse view. And I met so many amazing friends, and I found Iranian society such a pleasure to be with that has become a major inducement for me to keep coming back. I am a book publisher. And the reason I ventured into books was because I would go to bookshops and I couldn't find in those bookshops any books written by Iranians or by Singaporeans or by people from the Philippines or by people from, you know, many other parts of the world. And all the books that I could buy were written by Indians or by Westerners. means they were either written by people from the United Kingdom or by people from the United States. This was the universe of our books. And I found this very upsetting because I said that this cannot be possible, that all the thinking that we have should come only from the West. And that's when we decided to start a new type of bookstore in India, which was called the Other India Bookstore. And we said we will put a very challenging goal to this bookstore. And we said we will prohibit in this bookstore, any book that is written in the United Kingdom or in the United States of America. Every time you want to consult a source, the source is always a Western source. And you say, why should it be so? It's no longer, we can't blame now that this is the English who did it, and the Americans who did it, and the Portuguese who did it. Now we are in charge for the last 60 years. In India, we are in charge for the last 60 years. And we have done nothing to change the situation. We have done nothing to change the books. We have done nothing to change the methods of teaching. We have done nothing to write more books. We have done nothing even to change the way we compose our articles and our poems and our stories. We still imitate, we still copy. And as we know, when you copy something, you can never be creative and you can never be original.
My name is Munir Fasheh. I was born in Jerusalem in 1941. And in 1948, my family was expelled and went to Ramallah. And since then, basically, I was in Ramallah. I lived in the United States. I studied and worked. And then I went back to Palestine because that is the community that I really belong to. My struggle, I mean, I have been basically in education all my life. But I have been struggling against the dominant concept of education, the dominant practice of education. And I don't really believe that education is wrong because we are applying it wrong. No, education is, in my opinion, the very concept of education is wrong because it assumes that we can really give all students the same curriculum, the same textbook, and then we evaluate them with the same test.
4 years ago, when I decided I really needed to be back in my community, after spending 10 years at Harvard, where they say, where they don't say what they mean and they don't mean what they say, because everything they say relates to their career, I came back, I looked at Palestinian universities, and they are copies of that hypocrisy. So I decided not really to do anything with our universities. And the first group I worked with were women in a refugee camp, mostly mothers and teachers, and that they asked some kind of help with education and so on. Anyway, I went and spoke with them, and I told them what I can do before we agreed. I said, in a refugee camp like Shafat, which is close to Jerusalem, where drugs pour from the city into the refugee camp, mostly from Israelis, and where informers are many, and where that population of the camp in 2 years moved from 8,000 to about 25,000. So you can imagine the situation within the camp. I said, I have nothing to offer to you. I don't know anything about the camp. I know few theories and through a few words that I learned from books and universities and courses, but I cannot even understand the situation you are in. What you are doing, obviously, has a lot of knowledge that is not visible. If you can really survive in a situation like this and make children happy and make sense to them and still create in your homes a loving environment, then your knowledge, although it is not visible, it is without it, we cannot survive. Your knowledge is related to the basics of life, to the depth of living. It is related to survival. There is nothing in our universities and our schools that is related to survival. So all what I can do, and I'm ready to do it, is be like a mirror through which you see that all what you are looking for is already there. You already have it. Just because you don't have degrees, just because you don't have certificates, because no one is talking about the knowledge that you have, that doesn't mean you don't have it. So I'm going to keep reminding you of the richness and of the knowledge that you have. What I really want to say is to remind us all that what we are looking for is already within us, is already within our cultures, is already within life, and we have to, all what we have really to do is to open our eyes again, wake up, rather than follow the dominant way.